The Dustin Daniels Show. Broadcasting from beautiful downtown Phoenix. From the Faith Talk Studios in the Camelback Towers. Unashamedly proclaiming God's purity through His Son, Jesus Christ. Devoted to saving marriages. Dedicated to protecting children. Addressing sex with biblical truth and without shock value. You're listening to the intersection of life and lust. Call toll free at 1-855-5-DUSTIN. And now, here's your host, Purity Pastor Dustin Daniels.
Last week we had the privilege of speaking with Dr. Tim Kimmel of Family Matters, discussing his brand new book titled Grace-Filled Marriage. And Tim explained that most marriages have love. Yeah, lots of love, in fact, but when times get tough, marriages don't necessarily need more love. They need this element of grace. And if you missed last week's show, hey, no problem. Simply go to DustinDanielsRadio.com and listen to last week's show. You can meet Dr. Tim Kimmel. Learn more about Family Matters. You can visit his website, familymatters.net. You can see his photos, read his bio, and also order his books. Dr. Tim Kimmel is the founder and director of Family Matters, whose goal is to see families transformed by God's grace into instruments of reformation and restoration. Tim has authored many books, including Grace-Based Parenting, Raising Kids for True Greatness, and most recently, Grace-Filled Marriage and Connecting Church and Home. Tim, welcome back to the Dustin Daniels Show.
Glad to be with you.
Hey, we are going to continue our discussion from last week on your brand new book, Grace-Filled Marriage, and we're going to dive into this topic of what you call grace-filled sex. So my first question for you is, what does grace have to do with sex?
Well, what does grace have to do with our relationship with Jesus? Let's just take grace off the table in our relationship with Jesus. We got nothing.
Right, exactly.
We've got nothing. In a sense, let me define grace and see if that would make any sense on how it would connect to sex. If grace is giving somebody something they desperately need but don't necessarily deserve at the moment, then you could see how it plays heavily into sex. Because how often does a husband and wife come up with the idea of having sex with each other at the same time?
Right.
In enthusiastic, passionate sex. No, normally it's one person's idea and another person's responding. And it goes back and forth in marriages. But regardless, if somebody approached with that need at the midst of a life that things have just not been going well, and we feel that they have been pulling their weight, or life hasn't been fun around them, or they haven't been paying much attention to me or whatever, then why would we be inclined? And yet we come back to how God deals with us. And that's the bottom line of this book. You know, we need to treat each other the way God treats us. I mean, how often do we come to God with a need in a context of a just stellar lifestyle?
Right.
I mean, I can't recall ever.
Right.
And so I think this plays heavily in it. Also, Dustin, grace, the unique thing about grace is it's outwardly focused. It's not about me. It's about the other person. And grace is always trying to desire the needs and best interests of the other people that God brings into our life. And God says, I want you to be an agent of my grace. I want you to represent that as you live your life. Well, why? How? I mean, this would have a profound effect on our sexual lives.
You talk about the sexual relationship, mm-hmm, and with our spouse as the litmus test for grace. And I love that. Can you speak more on that?
Sure. Yeah, a litmus test is just something that we do that kind of shows whether certain conditions are in place in a scientific experiment or something. And so if our attitude towards our spouse is such that we're not responsive, we're not desirous, we're not kind, we're scorekeeping, we feel like they don't deserve it. Well, none of those things I just said have anything to do with God's heart of grace. And so I think the marital bed is just one of those great places to see how we're doing with God, because it requires us to give up ourselves on behalf of somebody else for their needs and best interests. And that's what God does with us all the time. So if we're not inclined to do that, and we're punitive in the process, it just says, you may be saved by grace, but you haven't figured out that this was supposed to
right.
rewrite your script.
Well, and last week we talked about the four lenses.
Yeah.
And the me lens, the love if lens, the pious lens, and then the grace lens. And isn't it amazing, Tim, how these four lenses have such a radical effect, not on just on our marriage as friends, but the one thing that defines the marriage as an actual institution, and that is the sexual relationship between one man and one woman. If we're living in the me lens or the love if lens, or certainly the pious lens, how is our sexual life with our spouse going to be? How's that sex life going to work out for us?
Well, it's not going to be fun for at least one of the people, probably both. It's going to fall far short of what the expectations were going in, because the me lens is totally self-oriented. The love if lens is all conditional. It's based on whether the person is deserving it at the time. And then the pious lens can be manipulative and cunning and rude and crude and all this other stuff, all in the name of Jesus. So, if you were in a relationship with somebody with those conditions, that can't be fulfilling. But Dustin, let's make sure, though, let me at least weigh in on something here that I just don't hear anybody in Christian books say. You have people listening to us right now that are married, and some people that are maybe considering married. There is really only one reason why two people get married.
Mm. Yeah.
Only one, or at least need to get married. Let me say that. Put it that way. There's only one reason. And that is to have sex with each other with God's blessing. And people might say, that is the most ridiculous, dumb. Did this guy go to seminary? Does he have a DR in front of his? Where does he come up? Okay, and I can prove it. I can prove it. People say, no, Tim. We got married because we really love each other. We're good friends. That's called friendship.
Right.
I have all kinds of people that I love and I'm friends with. I don't want to marry him. I don't have to marry him. We wanted to commingle our assets. We felt like we could. Those are called LLCs. Those are called corporations. They do not require a marriage license. Well, we like to travel, and we wanted to. Those are called tours. Simple question for the couples out there listening to us: when you got married, and you finally pulled away from the reception, left all your friends behind, where did you go?
To the honeymoon, baby.
Did you go to the bank and open up joint checking accounts? Did you go grocery shopping? You know, you went to a hotel and had sex with each other or something like that. Why? Because that's it. That's the unique feature. And because of that, God says, God introduces sex on the first chapter of the Bible, and he nails it again on the second chapter. And so this is a very important part of the whole thing, but I want it in a safe harbor of marriage. And so this is where we're coming from. And so to think that we get married, it's not that big of a deal to me. Well, this is the only outlet they have before God to meet that. And this is the unique thing that every couple has that they don't share with anybody else.
And it's a celebration of what God has done in the covenant,
yeah,
inside the institution of marriage. But Tim, before we get married, we're all sexually broken at some level.
Yeah.
We all carry this shame,
mm-hmm,
into the marriage. So don't you think that we fail to see this, what you're talking about, this design, God's design for sex, and we shy away from the discussion, and we shy away from the discussion even with maybe with our spouse and the shame that we have trying to figure this thing out.
Absolutely. I mean, there's the scar tissue that the average couple comes into a marriage with. And we talked in the book, you know, just the baggage that you pack to take off your honeymoon. It's more than clothing. It's history and it's regret. It's whatever. This is so standard. And now that, you know, it's very rare in a marriage prep course at a church where you have, it's very rare that you have couples that have never had sex or are not sleeping with each other. They've just thrown this whole priority of God's overboard, this generation. But let's go back to the cross. What was Jesus hanging there for? To pay that price and set us free from that.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. And he wants that to be a finished work, and he wants marriage to be something where he comes through and he cleanses us. He's cleansed us through the cross, and now he wants to restore us with each other. But I think, once again, our limited view of grace, we don't let him do that. And then we play games with each other.
You talk about the opposite of what grace-filled sex is. Sex as manipulation, sex as reward, sex as punishment, sex as an obligation. So let's start with sex as manipulation. We've all heard stories of examples of this. What are some of the underlying themes that maybe are running through our minds if we're kind of playing this game with our spouse?
Well, it's saying that I don't really care about having sex with this person. I only want something else, and I'm willing to give them this if I can get what it is over here I want. And so now, for, let's say that's the woman doing that, and the guy's saying, well, at least I'm having sex, so I'm fine with it, whatever. But in the long haul, you realize, no, this isn't what it's supposed to be. This is supposed to be two people whose hearts are bound together, not just their hips are bound together. And God wants this to be a great reward in our life. And so ultimately, that one leaves you. You know, it's kind of like that food that you eat that leaves you hungry afterwards.
Right.
You know, junk food and all. It's just not fulfilling.
Yeah. Because it's not really the manipulation, the reward, the punishment, and the obligation that we're discussing right now. We're missing, aren't we, the spiritual side of sexuality?
Yeah. Sex is physical. It's obviously emotional, but it's spiritual. And in fact, I say in the book, you know, God made Adam and Eve, and before sin entered the world, it said they were naked and unashamed. And I think to a certain extent, God gives us sex and marriage to say, I want to give you a little taste of what Eden was like before everything got messed up. I want you to be around somebody that you can be completely transparent and vulnerable with and not be ashamed or afraid about that. Now, I think that can only happen when Christ has done a great work in our life first.
Absolutely, yeah.
But then there's sex as a reward, and that's pretty obvious. You know, they're wanting us. They feel that somebody has done what they wanted them to do, so they're going to pay them back with sex. Anytime there's an exchange of money or reward for sex, it usually puts it in a different category as the oldest. And we don't want to have that kind of a sense in our in our marriage. And then for sex as punishment, this is where They're not getting sex because you just don't deserve it. It's not right. I'm not going to do it for you. And by the way, let's make sure people don't misunderstand. There are certain conditions in a marriage where crime, you know, felonies against the covenant have happened that are going to put a monkey wrench in the sexual relationship until things can be restored. We understand that.
Sure.
And then that obligation. I think I see this a lot in a misuse of scripture. Where men, it's usually the man saying to the woman, you know, this is what you're there for. You're supposed to do this, whether you feel like it, whether you're tired, whether whatever. It's your obligation. And they do it, and they say, okay, because and that's kind of an Old Testament, a skewered Old Testament aberration understanding of scriptures. It has nothing to do with a heart of graciousness. And so for Darcy and me, we got married. We figured we got to come up with something that's a whole lot better than these human default modes.
Yeah, because we still continue to keep a lot of score if we're doing this in our marriage.
And then I think you could summarize the whole two things into two extremes that I see out there. It's either demanding sex or defrauding sex. Mm. And like I say, there's nothing in the Bible that gives anybody the biblical right to demand sex and say, you have to give this to me because the Bible says so. It doesn't work that way. And then, of course, defrauding sex. And you know where I see defrauding sex many times is I see it when people had a lot of scar tissue coming in. They were maybe promiscuous or they were abused or some horrible crime happened to them. And that has not been a closed wound that God wanted it to be in the cross. We keep it an open wound and keep revisiting it. And so you get turned off and say, it doesn't do anything to me.
Right.
And say, well, what do you mean? That's what they married. They cast their lot with you. This was what the unique thing was. Well, we need to take that to the back to Jesus because that is defrauding the person. And Jesus said, I died. I put real blood on the line to set you free from that. Don't keep this an open wound. As long as you do, everybody loses.
Today on the show, Dr. Tim Kimmel, founder of Family Matters. You can visit his website at familymatters.net. And we are discussing his brand new book. It's called Grace-Filled Marriage. Last week, we talked about the overview of the book itself, that most marriages don't struggle with a lack of love. They simply struggle, possibly, from a lack of grace. And today, we're talking about a very small portion inside the book called Grace-Filled Sex, and this idea of what does grace have to do with sex? And I tell you, Tim, I loved also how you and Darcy are so vulnerable in this book and the stories that you share to be able to do that. I mean, I was laughing out loud as I was reading this stuff, and I would share it with my wife, Amy, and it was just really, really encouraging. Let's talk about your wife for a minute, yeah. Darcy, and she has some material in the book, and I thought this was just so important. She says that men think about sex as often as women think about their kids.
Yeah.
And that was a real light bulb for me, because how many times have we all heard men think about, these crazy stats of men about sex every 7 seconds?
Right.
I thought that was great. Can you say more on that, what Darcy was saying?
Well, yeah, and she had to realize, so you look at that, you say, well then, a lot of women say, well, men's just, they're just a pervert. No, wait a minute. They're wired. We're wired a certain way by God. And then we have this testosterone in us, and that's like getting a shot of sexual heroin every morning.
Sure.
And so that's why the thinking might be there. But obviously, if a man is a tender-hearted man who has submitted himself to God and he is driven by his grace, he doesn't want to use this in any kind of a manipulative or overbearing way. But we realize that in most marriages, one person's need seldom aligns with the other person's need at the same time or at the same level. And, it's a give and take. Sometimes she's more in the mood and I'm not, or I'm more in the mood and she's not. And we had to come up with some way to make sure that when that happened, as much as possible, we would have a willing, exciting heart for each other. And that's where Darcy came up with this concept of convenience store sex.
Convenience store sex. Say more.
Okay. Well, and we talk about this in the book, and we had to have some kind of a way of, and when we were first starting out, the convenience store movement was starting, the 7-Elevens and all that stuff, and Circle K's and things, but what was unique about them is that they were open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year.
Right.
In other words, they were always there and available. Now, that does not mean all the time, every time, regardless. This is talking about more of an attitude of the heart saying, I desire you. I may not have a particular appetite at this moment because of other things in my life and whatever, but I desire you. I'm here for you. I care for you. I desire to meet your needs, and especially because I don't want you going around hungry, and also I care for you.
Mm.
That's an attitude of grace. That's not that manipulative stuff you see that some people use, the overbearing stuff in the Bible. Nothing like it. It's just saying it's an attitude that God has towards us. He says, I am always here available for you and your unique needs.
Not going around hungry is a big deal, obviously. And you share this story, Tim, of obviously you do a ton of traveling.
Yeah, I do.
And you talk about having dinner with some other ministry leaders and they had this discussion about women maybe coming onto them, or maybe that was their perception, and all these guys were married.
Yeah.
And I loved your response. You talked to Darcy about this, and you said, I never really get that. What's wrong with me?
Yeah, I must have geek written all over my face, because in all my travels, no woman has ever come on to me.
And what did Darcy say? This is brilliant.
Oh, she said, well, that's because you have a red light on. And those guys either have a green light glowing from them or at least a yellow light.
So what's the green light?
Well, the green light is saying, I'm hungry, and I have needs, and they can, a woman can sense that, and she approaches, or I'm a little cautioned, but boy, I'm really in need. Whereas a red light saying, I'm satisfied, I don't need this, I'm fine, and don't even make a move, you'll get nowhere. Right. And see, I didn't understand all this, but Darcy says women can tell, they can just tell when a guy is looking for something more. And in our marriage, we just realized we've got to make sure that we're not sending each other around in life hungry, sexually hungry. And there's a way to satisfy and meet each other's needs and do it in a way that just draws our hearts closer and our lives closer. And it's the only thing that we get to enjoy with each other that we don't share with anybody else. But I think a lot of people are going around hungry because they've not let God's grace define their heart. And we keep ourself on the throne, and we'll always lose on that. And that's why this book comes along and says, there's a better way.
Going around hungry and living in what you're talking about, living in God's grace, in this grace-filled marriage, grace-filled sex, Tim, is we talk a lot about guardrails here on the program, and mm-hmm. people who struggle with pornography, who have had affairs because they are hungry and they're trying to work all this stuff out. But when you live in a grace-filled marriage, mm-hmm. you will set up guardrails. So, for example, some of my guardrails. I don't go to lunch with another woman alone. I don't ride in a car with a woman alone other than my mother or my spouse. I don't watch R-rated movies. Those are some of the guardrails, and that's some folks can say, that's really legalistic, Dustin. But at the same time, you know...
It's just common sense. And I think everybody kind of knows where their threshold is. But you know what? Let me throw something in there you don't normally hear. I think a lot of men and women wouldn't be as inclined towards pornography if a man could see, you know, he has access to his wife's naked body on an ongoing basis. And for women, mommy porn is more about the kind of the relational stuff, the romantic stuff. And if men were more romantic and tender and kind, in fact, I think a lot of men are their sexual life has been so framed by porn that they don't realize that what you see in porn is not how a normal man and woman who are tender towards each other would make love. It's more like what men think it should be, and in response, it's no fun for the woman. So if men are responding to a woman the way she normally needs, God designed her for, and a woman gave her body access to her husband, a lot of these things you just don't need it. You're not hungry. It changes everything.
Dr. Tim Kimmel is my guest with Family Matters, familymatters.net, speaking on his latest book, Grace-Filled Marriage. Tim, thank you so much for spending time with us. It has been a pleasure. 1 Corinthians 4:20, the kingdom of God isn't just a lot of talk, guys. It's living, and living in God's power. I love you. We'll see you next week.
The Dustin Daniels Radio Show is designed to provide accurate and authoritative information with regard to the subject matter covered. This information is given with the understanding that neither the host nor the station is engaged in rendering counseling advice for your personal situation. If you need further help, we encourage you to seek the services of a Christ-based counseling professional. For more information on the radio show, visit DustinDanielsRadio.com.